Well, it seems to have come in handy. Well, I'd like to introduce Charles-Éric, who's going to come on now and work on Brahms 2 with you. Bienvenue, Charles-Éric.
Thank you very much, Kelly. Hi, Maestro Shelley. Nice to meet you.
Thanks, fine. It's so nice to meet you.
I'll share my screen.
And are we starting with the first movement?
First movement, yes.
The second symphony, right?
Yes.
Thank you.
I'll finish here with the exposition.
No exposition repeat.
Yep. No repeat, yeah.
Good. Hey, great job. Very, very clear technique. Again, you would have had no problems, no issues whatsoever, you know, conducting that cleanly and doing a good job with it. And I think a little bit like, I don't know if you were listening along when I was working with Frédéric, but I think there are just some areas where we could go, you know, a step further in what you're indicating, and maybe some of the risks you take will actually then pay off. A question at the beginning, there's a pickup bar, then there's an 8 bar phrase, and then there's a 10 bar phrase, and they kind of together build an 18 bar phrase. Where is the continuity of line in the melody there? Which instrument has the melody in the second bar, for example?
What's the question again? In the second
bar, two of the
yes.
Which instrument has the lead voice, the melody line?
So it's the first horn.
Yes. And in bar, who has the melody line?
It's a third horn in.
No, in the bar six of the piece.
Oh yes, it's the first flute, the first clarinet, the first bassoon.
Okay, but which of those, in terms of register?
I'd say probably the flute.
But that means but alternatively, if you take the bassoon, you have right?
Yes.
Okay. And then back down to the bassoon as well. So look, you could of course say that the tessitura jumps from horn up to flute and then back down to horn and then back up to flute. But there is a continuity of line from the horn through to the first bassoon, back to the horn, and then to the bassoon again. And I just mentioned that because when you're thinking about the sonority of the beginning of the conductor, that's incredibly important, and the balance. And it doesn't happen naturally very easily. What happens is you hear horn, and then you will most easily hear the flute line and the clarinet, then you'll hear horn again, and you hear the flute and clarinet. So if you want it to happen, you need to make it happen. So I mention that because already that has an influence on the gestures that you'll be giving. So connect from the horn, if you have them there, across to the bassoon. You can indicate eye contact across to the bassoon, which will help them realize, maybe we're connecting our line there. Quite often they'll look at you like, why are you looking at me? What's going on? And you might need to mention it in the rehearsal then. And this is a particularly interesting set of voicings that, as so often with Brahms, need really interesting work in the, you know, in rehearsal in the woodwind and brass choir. Anyway, that's something I mentioned to you, that you can immediately think about these links in the sonority, because so much of Brahms is about finding those inner lines. So that's one thing to think of. The other thing is, what do you want them to do at the end of four bar phrases? Do you want them to sustain and connect to the next phrase? Or do you want there to be little gaps? Do you want it to feel like four bars, then four bars, then four bars, then four bars? But again, in a first rehearsal, this, and even in a performance, it might be that one of your hands goes across the bar line, if you want the connection, because it won't happen very easily naturally. What will normally happen is, right? So think about those sorts of things. Anyway, let's take the opening 16, 17 bars, okay, with just that in mind, please.
With or without music?
Let's take it with music. Just a danger. I think it's lovely that you're M1, but you have to be ready it won't necessarily be as simple as it is to conduct a recording, right? So you've got, do you imagine your cello's there or there?
Here.
Okay. And are you imagining first, seconds, or are you imagining first, seconds, cello, viola?
First, second.
But your horns are all there. So you can give, and you can give both three and two, and one, if you see what I mean. And is one option. One, two, three, one, two, three. Or one, two, three. Can you do those two? Can you tell me one, two, three, and then one, two. Beautiful. Now one and three. Great. Very well done, bravo. I think that, you know, even when you did it the first time, you were a little bit ahead of what the horns were doing. It's weird, right, with the recording. I get it completely. But I'd love to see you now when we repeat it to say, it's even then just a hint of the third. Do you see the way I did that? Yeah, it's just a, yeah, it's just, yeah. So let's try it without the music for a minute. Good. So the other thing is your hand is here, and I think what it says to me at the moment, your left hand is, you know, play and feel comfortable. It's nice. It's like, it's not really necessary. You know, you can have, but then, right? Because it's across that line that you're going to end up not getting the legato, because it's all those players stop playing and then new players come in. So we have the cello's basses. And by the way, once you have that feeling of resistance on the third beat, you don't really need to show it, because do you know what I mean? If once you're able to do that, you know, one, two, three, one, it becomes inbuilt. So one, two, three, one, two, three, one. So I just want to see you really allow your right hand to beat the opening, relax your left hand away, but in that fourth measure of the musical phrase, just connect across, okay? Yeah. Imagine you're just playing 3-1. Yeah. So 1-2-3-1. 1-2-3-1. Yeah. Do you see? Again, it'll have a an effect on the sound. If what I'm doing is 1-2-1. So that the tip of the baton lands softly. I don't do 1-2-3-1 or 1-2-3-1. 1-2-1. Because if you're playing clarinet and flute, you're waiting four bars and you want to see and. If I go and, I'm not going to get the same quality of piano, right? Good. Let's try doing that all with the left hand. Just the left hand. The beginning. Yeah.
Just the left. Okay.
Great. Super. One of the things I would then talk about next for both your right hand and your left hand is the question of hypermeter. So one of the reasons I was really pleased that you were indicating so much one at the beginning was that this music is, of course, in longer arcs. It's not music that's ti-da-ti-da-ti, you know, obviously it's not. So then you need to remember, we need to remember that we have another plane of indicating the music. So or wherever you want it to go, we have this plane, so a big four. And then from that big four, we also have a big eight and we have a big 16, right? So you can control the deeper level of the music there. So that's something I'd ask you if you're thinking about so in that shaping, I've already given the indication that we're going to go to the third bar, and we're going to come away, and we're not going to attack. When I say third bar, I mean third bar of the melodic line, and then we're not going to heavily attack the next downbeat. So could you take the opening again with just your left hand again, and see if you can give us a smooth feeling of the hypermeter. Good, super. Just do with me. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two. Good. And we have a line. It's actually that red line at the bottom of the painting in my room. That's your fingers are acting as the baton, please. So it's only the fingertips that hit the actual one, two, three, two, two, three, three, two, three, four, two. Now, and it's an obvious thing to mention, but between here and here, you only need half the speed that you need between here and here. Right, so one, two, three, two, two, three, three, two, three, four. So, and that's an easy, it's one of the reasons that threes are sometimes not in the right place, because unless it's really internalized, it doesn't. So one, two, three, two, two, three, two, three, four. So that's our basic coordinate, okay? And what we can do is within that, one, two, three, four, I'm giving one and I'm giving the hypermeter across the bars. I can also do one, two, three, two, two, three, 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 four. So I can show all three things at the same time, right? I can show the quarter notes, the dotted halves, and yeah, one, two, three, one, two, three. You can use your wrist, your fingers. We have so many options here, 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 and then these ones to give all of these things. But it's very, very useful for you who's already so, you know, you're consummate at beating one, two, three, you can do that till the cows come home. You can now add in these hyper levels. And of course, the same is true here. One, two, three, two, three, four. And suddenly when you start to use the space around you and you can start to give more information, even if the musicians will be like, but they'll feel it, right? They'll be like, why is he doing this? But then it'll be clear actually after a while what's happening. Yeah. So one other thing, the very first pickup you give, you know, we talked about la mer and how is enough. It's like the second bar of la mer. If you imagine, or one, two. Doesn't need to be too bouncy because it's just cellos and double basses either at the frog but possibly also at the tip. By the way, would you like them to play down or up bow to begin with?
Up bow.
Quite often it's not up, but that sets off the whole. It's like the whole pattern of events is wrong because we have downbeat bar, and it's like, what's just happened? So, yeah, it's a pickup bar. Okay, so let's maybe go a little bit further into the piece. When we have there, you don't need to beat so much. There's nothing really happening that's going to confuse anybody. It's really quiet and they can hear each other really well. And I think that then the continuum of sound, you'll get better. Remember that the firsts and the violas in this passage, they quite often change bow. In most parts, they change bow. And that's not a bad thing because you don't want people playing like this. But I think your primary concern here as a conductor is not to indicate three, but is to make sure that this makes completely smooth across there. And let's take the whole introduction of the exposition going into letter A one more time and you know, freestyle a bit. Try some things out, okay?
Sure. With music.
Sure.
Yeah.
Let me give you some options. Let's say we're here. That's, I promise you, it'll be enough. And if the horn is comfortable, if the horn's comfortable, this is enough. And if they're uncomfortable, nothing will be big enough, right? Because it's just a question of their mojo, you know? They're either comfortable or they're not. So, again, I'm just following the hypermeter, connecting. So when I said freestyle, you immediately, try it out, okay? Why not? There's nothing can go wrong. It's a pre-record anyway. So try using just one hand. Choose which one for the beginning and do the whole introduction with one hand. Again, bravo. The number of impulses you gave there for the timpani entrance and the trombone, it was one or two too many. So, timpani, trombones. Because again, it's an easy trap to fall into to think as a conductor, okay, now there's a trombone. And I need to make sure that it's clear where that comes. And to forget that the beauty of an orchestra is that it's an intelligent organism and a thinking organism. So the trombones have been sat there for like a minute going, and they've heard the violins go, right? Now there's reasons why the attack might not work. It might be that somebody's, you know, they can't create the piano very well and so it cracks and it doesn't speak or whatever, but it won't be because they don't have the pulse. And the thing is, if you make extra gestures, what it actually is saying is, oh, is something gonna change with the pulse? If you want it in tempo, just three, timpani, trombone. It's just super simple. If you want it to slow, then one, two, Oh, then you need to make it from doing a thing, but otherwise just let it go. For the first violin and viola entry, I think, you have two options, which is that either you trust that they can count three and that there's a magic to doing the following, which is, and they just come in there. So we don't go one, two, ga. Or if you want, it's possible you might want the dolce feature of the piano. But in which case, it's still not really necessarily about a rhythmic thing. It's saying, and, right? It's giving a little bit more than rhythm. It's saying one, two, wa. My personal choice there, I find it incredibly magical when you just give them a horizontal gesture, because then what you have is this, they play, but it's like just a whisper there coming in. But like I say, the other alternative is perfectly reasonable, but I think then give them more of a sense of why you're giving them the entry, yeah? The other thing I'd mention is that in that line, the woodwind need to cut off cleanly together on the third beat of their last bar. You can even do that with the eyes. So let's say you're doing what you did, which is beautiful, to be really calm. One, two, three, four. You can just do that. Three and four. And it just makes them know, okay, he's checking that, and we know that it's a clean cut off. Or, you know, just have that in mind. Good. And I'd love to see you do the opening one with him. I was really enjoying it. Let me just show you what I think the difference between what you're doing at the moment is and what you could do. So you're sort of, you're here and so it's around there, okay? I think you could use this space a bit more. So we say, and so it's just this sense of it gives a bit more air and movement in the sound, because if one's this, it's possible that it compresses a little bit into slightly tighter sound. So if you want that feeling of a piano that is supported, maybe use this a little bit more. It doesn't mean angular, but use the space, okay? So let's take the opening one more time, and then we'll go into the beautiful first theme at A. Thank you, a really good job. Tell me, if you were to describe what that moment should feel like. I'm not asking you to find the perfect words, but what would you say is that moment in the context of what we've heard already?
It's like if the bars before, if something very stuck in a way, we don't really understand what's happening because of the instrument, the orchestration being so potent, and then it flourishes, it blossoms into some unity. And
so what you just did with your hands, it blossoms. Okay, that gesture you didn't do at that moment, and you're absolutely right, it's the right gesture. What you did was a down gesture, but it's if you do that, it's that gesture, I promise you the orchestra will breathe into that moment. Okay, so you don't need the downbeat. I know you're probably thinking of the pizzicato and the violas and the cello being toddy, 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 but that'll happen. The main priority is the getting nice and clean. And again, it doesn't need so much beating, it's breath, yeah? The pizzicato before that in the double basses, unless you think it really needs to be featured, is actually just a doubling of what the tim has. So we have the trombones and timpani, trombones and clarinet. That's all you need for the pizzicato. Because again, they hear one, two, three. It's not going to be wrong. And if it's wrong, it's because somebody there is going like that. Yeah, it's like, that's the only problem. If they're thinking, it'll just happen naturally, okay? Again, yeah, I just think about expanding that. Do you, partly for people listening, but that phrase and what he does at the beginning is so extraordinary. If people want to have fun, they can take the four bars of that phrase at letter A and look at the constituent parts and how basically in the first eight measures, he gives us every little bit of that broken down into its DNA. And that's another one of the reasons that it feels so special, because actually he's, like you said, he's made sense suddenly of all these ideas that came before. Listen, other things just quickly that jump out at me when we did this the first time. I don't know if you've conducted this yet with an orchestra, so you may have had experience yet. Okay, but when you do, 1-3-6, for example, is 1-3-5, 1-3-6, be very aware of keeping a tight control on the coordination. You did, but it's easy to underestimate how quickly that little moment can go wrong, because the viola is playing da 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 da, and people lose the orientation. So tim bum ba ba bi lum ba da bi rum ba 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 ba. Another thing to think about there is also balance. This poco forte is very important, I think, in 1-3-6, both in the entire orchestra, because if you truly get it, then what you can have is a build from 1-3-6 all the way to the fortissimo in 1-5-2. But for my taste, too often what happens is that the intensity of the fortissimo at 1-3-5 is sustained at 1-3-6. And it means we then lose the line. So another thing that's important is to hold on to the ensemble, but to indicate the new sound. So we arrive, tim, pum, pa, pa, pim, pum, pa, pa, pum, pa, 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 and go into a different place so we can build the line. Yeah. This was lovely. Great. I think if you can transpose some of the ideas I talked about in the beginning all the way through the movement, you might develop some interesting tools, which is, you know, that hypermeter, how you can conduct the detail, but also then have the hypermeter. If you work on that, I think it might give you some interesting options. And the other thing, I mean, you picked this recording, which is very beautiful. One thing that the whoever it is decides to do is to make the opening very even, right? So the thing I'm talking about with the indication of the hypermeter doesn't quite match aspects of the recording. But again, even if it's only a minimal amount, Brahms is such a fundamentally classical composer. It is... despite the weight of sound that's useful and the sonority and yes, the passion of the music, I think it's very, very useful and important for a conductor to be giving the classical architecture what's happening. So even if you want the particular approach to sound and dynamic that's in that recording, which is beautiful, I still think it's a useful thing to practice. But it was a great pleasure to meet you, Charles-Éric, and bravo.
Thank you. Great pleasure for me too. Thank you very much.
Merci beaucoup, Charles-Éric. C'était fantastique. Thanks, Alexander. I wonder if I could ask Alain to come back on for a minute and maybe give us his impressions of the class as it went today. I think